Jesus' special places for spiritual retreat and refreshment was at the home of Martha and Mary and their brother Lazarus that we have read about here today. Their home was located in the village of Bethany. It was just a short distance east of Jerusalem. You went down from the temple, down the valley, and over the hill, and down about 2 miles from the temple. It was from there that on Palm Sunday, the Lord rode the donkey into Jerusalem. To this home, the Lord Jesus Christ went many times. It was a very special place where he could rest and relax among friends. The gospel story today is a record of a visit Jesus paid to the house of Mary and Martha. And the story follows the parable of the Good Samaritan. And together, these two events in the life of Jesus provide the Christian with an example of how to live the life of faith. Jesus shows in the story that what we need in the Christian life is a balance. A balance between work and worship. A balance between doing and listening. A balance between a faith that is active in love and a faith that is renewed by the Word of God. When Christians lose this sense of balance here, their priorities get all out of focus. They become distracted by other things. And they start manifesting attitudes and behaviors that are not very Christ-like. This is the lesson of the story. We begin the story by looking at the sisters in the home. Although Mary and Martha were sisters, they were very different in their personalities and in their temperament. Mary and Martha have been symbols of two aspects of Christian life. Mary represents the disciple who is a worshiper, receptive, meditative, and emotional. We first encounter Mary in this story, and she is sitting at the feet of Jesus. Now, in the Middle East, to sit at the feet of someone, it symbolized discipleship. It was a posture that was assumed by a student in order to learn and to receive from the teacher. Mary loved being at the feet of Jesus. Every time we ever meet Mary, throughout all the scriptures, that's where we find her. In this passage, she is sitting at the feet of Jesus, and she's listening to his word. And in John 11, chapter verse 32, at the resurrection of Lazarus, she falls to the feet of Jesus, acknowledging him as Lord of life. In John 12, chapter 32, at the anointing of Jesus, Mary wipes the feet of Jesus with her hair, preparing him for burial. Mary just loved being at the feet of Jesus. It's like the Apostle Paul. Her desire was to know Christ, to know the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings. Sitting at the feet of Jesus, that is the first posture for the disciple here of any Christian. The Reverend Howie Childs was a retired minister. He tells the story of how he learned to ice skate on a frozen pond up in Michigan. They drove the car practically up to the edge of the ice. Howie put his feet on while a shoe on, his skates on, while he was sitting in the front seat of the car. And when he was ready, he hollered to his son, "Are you ready to go?" Son said, "Dad, you go on first." And like many people, Howie had learned a little something about skating in an ice skating arena. And when you learn to ice skate in an arena, you begin by holding on to all the rails. But a frozen pond in Michigan doesn't have any rails to hold on to. So Howie was thinking, how am I going to get started here? Maybe by holding on to the side of the car and giving myself a little push. So he pushes off from the car, and guess what happens? He lands flat on the behind. He tries to get up, but he can't. His feet keep sliding every which way. There are no rails for him to grab a hold of and again pull himself up. Just then, some of the neighborhood kids from the church come passing by. They've been watching Howie out there struggling in vain to get up on his feet. Finally, one of the boys shouts, "Reverend, if you want to stand up and skate, you have to get on your knees first." you a Martha or are you a Mary? When you think of Mary, you think of worship. When you think of Martha, you think of work. It reminds us that there needs to be this balance in our lives between worship and work. Do you have a place for worship in your life? Do you have a place for work in your life? Now we've looked at the two systems in the home. Now notice the theme that's in the house there. Try to picture, if you will, the theme that is going on there. Mary is sitting there eating with Jesus. The disciples, if they are present, they are reclined in various points all around the room. Jesus is teaching. Martha is out there in the kitchen. She's preparing the meal. Such a beautiful scene. Do you picture all of it in your mind? This is only the quiet of the storm. Trouble is brewing in the kitchen. Martha is flaming over that hot stove. And she did not have a microwave, nor did she have an oven range. Her stove was an open fire of dry thorn bushes and camel's dung. And it was hot. And the stove was not the only hot thing in the kitchen that day. Suddenly, Martha burst from that kitchen into the dining room. She got a rolling pin in her one hand. There is lightning in her eyes, and the thunderstorm breaks. Luke 10:40 says, Martha became angry because she had so much work to do. So she went in and she said, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me all alone to do all of the work? Tell her to help me. Martha has come unglued. She is distracted by all that needs to be done. She becomes resentful toward her sister Mary. She starts dictating to Jesus. The Savior's solution. Martha, the Lord answers. You are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what's better, and it will not be taken away from her. See, Jesus calms Martha's anxiety. He says, Martha, you are worried about many things. And this word worry means that you are torn in two different directions. You're being pulled apart. And that's what worry does to a person. It takes your heart, it takes your mind, and it pulls them apart. And that's what happened to Martha. And as a result, she is falling to pieces. She's coming apart on things. The thing about worry is that much of our worry never comes to pass. Philippians 4:6 says, do not be anxious about anything. And 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your anxiety on Him. So Jesus calms Martha's anxiety. And He can do the same for all of us. And Jesus corrects Martha's priorities.
says, Martha, Martha, only one thing is needed. Martha, you are so busy doing things for me that you do not take time like Mary to be with me. Martha, what does that say about your priorities?
Little boy, correct? Connects. Well, and Jesus, a little boy went to visit Grandma's house one day. And while he was there, Grandma pulled out her game of Monopoly. She spread it all out there on the dining room table. And the two of them sat down and they began playing Monopoly. Now Grandma, she killed her. Monopoly player. She pulled those dice. She started whipping around that board, buying up all the properties and accumulating huge sums of money. And within just a short period of time, her grandson was slain. He was bankrupt and that game was all over. Eric asked Grandma if she wanted to play again. He said, son, you need to learn how to play a game. When you learn how to play a game, you come back and we'll sit down and we'll play. Boy, that really motivated us a little bit. So he decided he was going to learn that game. So he went home and persuaded his mom to buy him a game of Monopoly. He asked Dad to read and explain all of the rules to this game. He began playing that game all on his lonesome. But it gave him the opportunity to hone in on his skills. Then he played the game with his older sisters until he could beat every one of them. Then he played the game with Mom and Dad until he could beat them. He played the game with his neighbors until he could beat all of them. He could beat everyone. Not long before he knew this game of Monopoly backward and forward, he was amazed at Monopoly. So he picked up the phone. Grandma, are you ready? Over to Grandma's house. Out comes the Monopoly board. The dice begin to roll and they both tear around the board, buying up everything in sight, accumulating property and money. And then suddenly, roll of the dice. That little guy gets a big break. He lands on the board walk. And he buys the property. Then he buys the other properties that accumulate wealth like none of the others. Grandma fights the dust. Wow. You guys, man, this little guy feels so good. Grandma says, son, you learned to play the game. And you've learned it well. Now you have to learn the toughest. All wide-eyed, the little fellow looks at Grandma and says, what's that, Grandma? She replies, that the toughest lesson to learn about the game is this. When the game is over, it all comes back into the box. That is life. We run around playing this Monopoly. So busy making living, buying properties, raising kids, cooking the meals, paying the bills, grabbing lifestyles, saving and investing, serving the church as a minister of the Lord for you.
And yet so often we forget the most important lesson of the whole game of life. That when the game is over, thank you.